Welcome back. In the last class, we looked at the application of material balance equation or the useful form of the mass balance equation to derive something useful from a macroscopic system. In this class, we will take that forward. Let me show you the use of the material balance equation, the useful form of the material balance equation to microscopic systems. This is of again direct interest to us. I am going to show you how to apply it to a biological cell. A biological cell, even though it's only a few microns in diameter or its dimension, it still can be considered as a continuum because of the number of molecules of interest being large enough. Or if it is large enough, the rule of thumb is about 100 molecules per cell. If you have something beyond that, you can consider that as a continuum. So if it is a continuum, then you can apply any of the principles that we are covering in this course. Let's move forward. So this is application to microscopic systems, a biological cell. You've done a lot of basic biology courses and you know that thousands of reactions occur in the cell simultaneously. In fact, it is those reactions and those reaction networks that provide functionality to the cell, to the biological cell. They are also essential for the normal cell functionality. The bioproducts are made as a result of such reaction networks. That is what bioprocess engineers are interested in. Metabolic flux analysis was a method of analysis of those reacting systems that was developed, let us say, about 40-45 years ago and applied about 30 years ago to improve the productivity of a biological system, of a bioreactor. Since then, it has been successfully used to even modify cells, genetically modify cells through insights into metabolic changes towards significantly improved product yields. The basis for this metabolic flux analysis, this is the method of analyzing, or one of the methods of analyzing the biological reaction networks, is nothing but material balance. That's what we are going to see next. To do that, consider this as a biological cell. I've drawn it nicely as an oval here. You know that the cell can be of any shape and size and so on. Let us consider this to be a cell, and we are going to consider the cell as our system, as indicated by these dashed lines. This is the system boundary here. We are going to consider a typical network, a reaction network that is occurring in the cell, a very, very simplified form of the network. Here, let us say that a substance S0, a substrate S0 in the extracellular space, gets taken in by the cell and probably gets converted in the process, we don't know, to something called S. Yeah, let's say that it gets converted to something called S. The S gets converted to A through one set of reactions and to B through another set of reactions. And A gets converted to C, which is actually coming out of the cell, an extracellular product, and B gets converted to D through a set of reactions, and D is also coming out of the cell. The rates for these steps, the rates are in millimole per second, okay, or millimole per gram cell per second. This is more the practical unit because this is how it is measured. It could be millimole per second for principle, it could be this for practical reasons. Let us say that the rate of this process S0 to S is R0. The rate of S to A is R1, the rate of S to B is R2, and the rate at which A gets converted to C and gets pushed out is R3, the rate at which D gets out of the cell through from B is R4. Although these are rates, they have been called fluxes or metabolic fluxes from a historical perspective. That's the term that it began with, and that's the term that has stuck. Okay. Note the unit here is millimole per second. We will call this flux as an exception in this course, in this context, and maybe in probably a couple of other contexts, which we'll get to later in the course. The normal meaning of flux in this course is different, that we'll get to soon in the next chapter. For now, let us call this rate as flux, fully well realizing that we are going to change this definition of flux very soon to fit into the main theme of the course or the main definitions in the course. For looking at the intracellular metabolites, which are the intracellular metabolites here, S, A, and B. For the intracellular metabolites S, A, and B, we are going to consider the intracellular space as our system. Okay, that's what we're going to focus on. The rest we are going to consider as surrounding. Whereas for the extracellular metabolites, which are S0, C, and D, we are going to consider the extracellular space as a system. We are going to focus on the extracellular space and do our balances based on that. So, if we consider the extracellular space as a system, the intracellular space becomes a surrounding. Okay. This is not so difficult to understand. It will become clear very soon. But just keep this in mind. This is a trick that we need to do to get a consistent set of equations that we can work with, or to get a consistent set of relationships that we can work with. That's the reason why we are doing this. So, this is the cell, the same cell, S0 to S, S to A to B, and then A to C and B to D here. Now, we are going to apply this equation. This is the useful form of the material balance, Ri input rate minus output rate plus generation rate minus consumption rate equals the accumulation rate of that particular species that we are interested in. This equation we said is very general. We can close our eyes and apply it over a system. It should work fine. So, that's essentially what we're going to do now. We're going to close our eyes and apply this and see what the various terms are. So, let us consider the intracellular metabolites first. For the intracellular metabolites, as we mentioned, the cell is our system. And let us consider them one by one. Let's start with S. So, if you do a balance on S, which is essentially writing the various terms in this equation for the intracellular system, there is a certain input rate of S, that is R0. There is no output of S, there is no output rate of S, no S is going out. There is no generation of S. We'll come to this in a little bit. There is, of course, consumption of S through the reactions leading to A and through the reactions leading to B. The rates of those are R1 and R2 respectively. Therefore, minus of R1 plus R2, that's minus R1 minus R2, equals the rate of change with time of S in this space. Okay. Now, let us look at this particular aspect alone. S naught, the balance is on S. We said S R naught is the input rate. Here, what has happened is the process of S naught in the extracellular space to S in the intracellular space is a number of individual reactions. Okay. All that has been combined into this, and that is normally done in this analysis. A set of reactions are combined into one step, one representative step, and that is what has been done here. You could look at this as S getting input into the cell at a rate of R0, or S getting generated in the cell from whatever S not getting in and so on and so forth at a rate of Rg. It could be either of those. It cannot be both. If you do it as both, then you are double counting the same thing. Okay. So essentially we need to avoid double counting. Therefore, you could either consider such things as either an input or as a generation because of some complexity involved, you know, S not going to S. If it is just A inside going to A outside, it's a clear output rate, or A outside coming to A inside, it's a clear input rate. That is not the case here. Here, because of the way the analysis is done, a lot of things are combined into one step. And therefore, we need to be a little careful. Do not double count. That's the bottom line here. Okay, fine. So let me go through this again. A balance on S, input rate of R0. There is no output, there is no generation in this case, we have already accounted for in the input. The consumption is through rates R1 and R2, and since the RC is negative, we have minus R1 minus R2 equals dS dt. Fine? Okay, let's move forward. Let's write the balance on A. Is there an input rate of A? No, there is no crossing of A across the system boundary. Is there an output rate of A? Yeah. Is there a generation rate? Yes. No, there is no output. The A, when it goes out, it is actually C through a set of reactions. So there is no output. There is certainly a generation from S. There is a consumption here. And therefore, the various terms are R1, which is the generation rate from S, and R3, which is the consumption rate of A through the set of reactions, and that equals dA dt. Balance on B, just be with me, it will become second nature very soon. Balance on B, which is this intracellular, therefore we are considering this as our system. There is no input rate, there is no output rate. There is a certain generation rate R2, there is a consumption rate R4, and therefore R2 minus R4 is dB dt. So we have looked at S, A and B, which are the intracellular metabolites. Now we have S naught, C and D, which are the extracellular metabolites. When we said that when we look at extracellular metabolites, we need to consider the extracellular space as our system, so that is going to be our focus. So whatever gets out of the extracellular space into the intracellular space will be an output from the system. Whatever is getting into the extracellular space will be an input, and so on and so forth. Okay. A balance on C, which is this, would therefore be, you know, there is an input rate here, there is into the system. There is no output rate of C, C is not going out anywhere. There is no generation of C, we have already accounted for it in the input. There is no consumption of C, and therefore R3, which is the input rate, therefore plus R3 equals dC dt. Okay, there is an input rate here, which is R3. I am just aligning these for a certain reason, which will become clear in the next slide. So R3 is dC dt is the balance on C. The balance on D, why don't you take a second and write it, then I'll show you what it is. Can you do that? Pause the video if you want now, write it and then check it. That might be a little easier for you. Hopefully you'd have gotten this. D we are focusing on with the extracellular space as our system. There is an input rate of R4, there is no output rate, D is not going out of the extracellular space. There is no generation of D, there is no consumption of D, and therefore plus R4 is dD dt. There is one more, right? There is an S0 or S0 remaining. So let's do a balance on S0. I'm just placed it here for a certain reason. The S0, if you look at it from the point of view of extracellular space, S0 is getting into or getting out of the system at a rate of R0 into the intracellular space, which happens to be the surroundings here. There is no output, there is no input rate, there is an output rate of S0 from the system to the surrounding. There is no generation rate, there is no consumption rate, and therefore minus R0, because this is the output rate here, equals ds naught dt. Okay. So, there were 6 metabolites and these are 6 balances that we have written. And these balances, does this remind you of something? You know, I took pains to align things and write this this way. Does this remind you of something? Yeah, it reminds you of a mathematical way of writing it. They can be written in a compact form as this, as matrices, right? You know how to do matrix multiplication, minus 1 into R naught plus 0 into R1 plus 0 into R2 plus 0 into R3 plus 0 into R4 equals d dt of S naught. Okay, that was the equation here, S naught. So that we got nicely by this matrix multiplication here by representing the involved aspects as matrices, we can do that. Okay. So, in one compact way, we have represented the entire set of 6 reactions. In a normal cell in analysis, there could be thousands of reactions, 1,000, 3,000, 4,000 reactions are very common when you do this kind of an analysis. And it is not possible to individually write down and keep track. Even writing down those reactions would take so many pages and it's not going to be very effective. So, if you write this in a mathematical form, you can just put this into a program, computer will spit out the results and you have it. You have whatever you're looking for there. So, that's the reason for converting this into a matrix form. So, this can be, calling this equation 1.2-9, this is to be consistent with the equation numbering in the book. It will not be continuous in these lectures as I mentioned earlier, but this will correspond to the lecture, the equation number in the book, so it's easier for you to follow. So, here you could call this a S matrix dot R matrix, the rate matrix or rate vector, equals d dt of this vector, x vector, which is the vector of these concentrations here, these state variables here. Okay. So, let us call this equation 1.2-10. S is called the stoichiometric matrix, R is the reaction rate vector and x is the state vector or the vector of state variables. In this case, it happens to be concentrations in the extra and intracellular spaces. So, using the principle of material balance, the basic principle of material balance, we have converted metabolism in the cell, network of thousands of reactions, into a form that can be analyzed for various ends, to improve productivity, to understand what's happening inside, and so on and so forth. That's a very hot area of research, or a very important area of research even now. From the viewpoint of diseases and so on and so forth, a lot has been is being done. So, this, the basis of all that is nothing but material balance. And this is to quantify fluxes further for metabolic flux analysis. This, I've just given you the representation, I've not given you the analysis here. You need to analyze this further in the way that you want for your particular need to come up with insights. So, that is an example of the application of the very powerful principle material balance to a microscopic system, in this case a biological cell. See you in the next class, we'll take this further when we meet next. See you then.